Okay, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm John Strickland from JLS Consulting. Welcome to the World Travel Market 2017 Aviation Sessions. I'm delighted to be hosting them again this year. We've got three different sessions for you this afternoon. For, I think, the first time ever at WTM, I'm actually going to present a little bit about the airline industry, what is going on right now. And if any of you have looked at the blog I've done for the WTM website, which I've called The Good, The Bad and The Ugly, as reflects the airline industry, that really is a flavour of what the last year has been like for the airline business. I'll talk about that and what is going on for about 20 minutes or so, maybe the chance for a couple of questions or debate points if you wish to join in. Then at 4 o'clock, we'll have our first guest, who is the chief executive of the Icelandic airline WOW, who's making a big mark in the transatlantic arena and across to Europe with a very new style of airline service. And at 4.45, I'm very pleased to say we've got, in his first substantial interview since he took the role of CEO at BA, we've got Alex Cruz. So Alex will be joining us at 4.45. So hope you enjoy the sessions. Hopefully there'll be the chance for you to ask some questions. And let's kick off right away and see what's been going on in this industry. Well, it really has been a case of turbulent skies in the last year. Times are perhaps always turbulent, always challenging for the airline business. The question is, how do airlines get through that, or do indeed all airlines manage to get through the challenges they face? So I'll look at a few themes now, which I think are perhaps most important to the well-being and the health of the airline industry as we know it today. Well, fuel prices, of course, are very much a double-edged sword for airlines. 2 years ago, people who called themselves experts in fuel prices were saying that fuel was only going one way, that was upward. We were going to see fuel at above $200 a barrel. Now we've seen fuel down as low as $35 a barrel. It's currently around, I think, about $55 currently. But the price is extremely low. It's been that way for the last couple of years. Now, that's a double-edged sword from an airline point of view. You would think that all airlines would be delighted to have low fuel prices because it cuts a lot of cost out in their business, of course. The challenge is that as fuel began to fall, we saw a lot of airlines deciding to maintain capacity in the market that they would have perhaps taken out if fuel prices had been higher because it wasn't terribly profitable. We've seen other airlines getting hold of old aircraft or taking old aircraft that had been removed from service and putting them back into service again and providing a lot more capacity to the marketplace. And the consequence of that in certain markets is that airlines have been forced to cut prices. So from a consumer point of view, it's been good. Prices have been coming down in a number of areas. But from an airline point of view, many of the hard-won gains in reduced fuel prices have been given back in simply lower revenues. Now, those of you who are based here in the UK or around Europe will know that consolidation is very much a watchword of the industry. It's important that the industry does consolidate. For a long time, there have been too many players, too many airlines chasing too few customers. But we've had a couple of quite poignant and sad disappearances as part of that consolidation process recently. As I said, those of you who are based here in the UK will know the long-established household name, a very proud airline name, Monarch, who had been around for almost 50 years. Well, just this last month, Monarch finally went out of business. Beginning of October, they didn't even make it to the end of the summer season. A whole host of factors came into play. The fuel price that I mentioned was one factor, that depressed prices, the nature of their market and their activity in the Mediterranean. They faced more competition from very large operators. And in the end, they couldn't make it, and that airline has now disappeared into the ever-increasing airline graveyard. Now, another airline who's also been around a good number of years, very sad disappearance, not quite as dramatic in that it was expected and it was even planned for a particular date just a week last Friday, is Air Berlin. Air Berlin flew its last flight just over a week ago in Germany. Again, a major airline who's been around for 30, 40 years. It just wasn't fitting in the airline world as we know it today. It had been losing money for a long time. Had it not had investment from the Gulf carrier, Etihad, it may well have disappeared even sooner. But unlike Monarch, which has simply failed overnight, and questions are remaining about what will happen with its slots. Indeed, this week, we may hear whether airlines are going to be able to buy those slots from the liquidator or whether they will just go back into the airport slot pools that they flew from. Air Berlin was a much more managed disappearance. Lufthansa had big ambitions to increase its dominance in the German market, and effectively it will take the lion's share of capacity which Air Berlin had in the German market and around Europe, and indeed long haul. The rest will be taken by EasyJet. But for the time being, if you were to go to Berlin Schönefeld Airport, you would see an enormous line of Air Berlin aircraft lined up, grounded, looking for some new work to do. So they are both victims of the consolidation process. Other airlines might say, well, they're not victims. It's a good thing they've gone. It means some capacity is going out of the market. We need that to tightening up so we can try to improve our profit margins. But the third one on this list, of course, is Alitalia. Now, Alitalia, with no offence intended to any Italians in the room, but you could say Alitalia's had a number of near-death experiences over the years, quite a number. And the question is this going to be another near-death experience for Alitalia, or is it going to rise like a phoenix from the ashes? Well, we just don't know. This was supposed to be sorted out this month, or indeed last month, October. The airline was already in administration. The Italian government was looking for new buyers. A number of airlines have put bids in, but for whatever reason, it's been put off again. So Alitalia lives to fight another day. It lives to fly through the winter season. But maybe this time next year, we'll know what has happened. I'd be surprised if it remains 100% as it is today, as a complete airline entity. I think it's more likely to be broken up into smaller bits. And we see already in Italy that airlines like Ryanair and other low-cost carriers are already far and away the most dominant players in the short-haul market. But these three airlines provide an indication of what's going on in the marketplace. There are other players too in Europe who could well fail or be bought out, particularly as we look into a more difficult winter period of trading. If we compare this process of consolidation, though, between what's happening here in Europe and what's happening in the USA, the pattern is the same, but the extent of the consolidation is quite different. You see in the top here, in Europe, the top five groups, which happen to be three legacy groups, by which I mean the large network carriers, Lufthansa, Air France, KLM Group, and IAG, and the two leading low-cost carriers, account for only around about 50% of available seat kilometres in the marketplace. Now, as it happens, the USA also has a top five, which is composed of three legacy groups, United, Delta, and American, and two Southwest, so two low-cost airlines, Southwest and JetBlue, but they account for almost 90% of the available seats. So the consolidation process has gone much further in the USA, and those airlines are in a much better state of health, much more profitable than we see generally in Europe currently. Now, within this consolidation process and within the change in structure of the market, there are always winners and losers. We've seen some of the losers on the earlier slide, but amongst the winners, we have the low-cost carriers, and far and away, they're moving ahead to a bigger and bigger market share. This is for a number of reasons. There is massive fleet growth, and we're also seeing what perhaps might not have seemed possible only a couple of years ago, a number of these low-cost carriers like Ryanair, who always pursued a strategy of focusing on secondary airports around Europe, has moved more and more into primary airports. You wouldn't have imagined two or three years back that you would see Ryanair in Brussels, Zaventem. Certainly you wouldn't have imagined to see Ryanair in Frankfurt, Main Airport, in addition to their own Frankfurt Airport, which of course is Hahn. Now, the sheer scale of their operation, the whole nature of their pricing, means they themselves are putting pressure on average yields, average prices in the marketplace. Now, this just provides an indication of the kind of fleet growth we are seeing from these airlines. Just looking at the three that I mentioned, Wizz, EasyJet, and Ryanair, Norwegian I'm going to talk about separately in a few moments. Only a year or so ago, they had a combined fleet of about 600 aircraft. By 2021, based on current orders, that will be up to 1,000 aircraft flying the skies of Europe. And it's not only that they're adding more aircraft, they're adding bigger aircraft. So EasyJet is upgrading from the A320 to the A321. Wizz is doing the same thing. And Ryanair is going from the 737-800 to the 737 MAX, which has about 8 additional seats in its configuration when Ryanair brings that into service. Now, 8 seats doesn't sound that much, but when you think Ryanair is going to get 100 to 200 of these aircraft, and you multiply that times the number of flights these planes do every day, that's a massive jump in capacity in the marketplace. We're also seeing new business models developing in the industry, and the flavour of the month, you could say, the business model which is on everybody's tongue right now is long-haul low-cost. Well, short-haul low-cost is established now not only in Europe, but globally it's really proved itself. It delivers high levels of profitability. Millions and millions of customers use this airline business model around the world. But long-haul low-cost is a somewhat newer animal. There are not many big proponents who have been around up until now. We've had AirAsia X out in Kuala Lumpur. We've had Norwegian developing here in Europe, first from being a short-haul low-cost carrier and then to being long-haul low-cost, and having introduced a big fleet and a growing fleet of Boeing 787 Dreamliners. The model is very much based on offering low fares to the long-haul customer, just like short-haul low-cost. But to do that economically, it needs very fuel-efficient aircraft. And that's really what Boeing's 787 is delivering and Airbus's A350. But there are more challenges to this business model than there are for short-haul. You can't simply copy-paste the recipe for short-haul low-cost and cut it over to long-haul. Not all of the markets you might wish to fly in are big enough. Not all of them are consistent in their traffic volumes all year round. There's a high level of seasonality. A lot of the traffic is, like short or low cost, very price sensitive, leisure traffic. And that doesn't necessarily mean you can make a profitable long-term operation unless you feed passengers in from other destinations, in some ways like hub carriers do, to offset the weak periods of operation or to deal with smaller markets. And the other challenge, if your message is only about price, are you losing revenue by not having a premium service? Now, some low-cost carriers do have a premium cabin. If we look at the slide here, Norwegian and Level both have a premium cabin. They don't call it business class, but the fares are substantially higher and the thrills are included. WOW doesn't have a business cabin, and we'll be talking about that to the CEO in a few minutes. Now, within long-haul low-cost, we're also seeing a move to more small markets. And I mentioned the importance of the Boeing 787 and the A350, but we're seeing smaller aircraft, some of which used to be primarily in the short-haul market, like the good old Boeing 737 and the Airbus A320. New models of those aircraft are coming out, which you can see clearly on this slide. Norwegian, as well as getting 787s, is introducing the Boeing 737 MAX, which is allowing to do long-haul flights from Western Europe to the eastern seaboard of the USA. And this map, which they showed in one of their investor presentations, shows all the kind of shorter long-haul routes that this smaller plane can do worldwide. Now, on the face of it, it looks like an amazing opportunity. But maybe being a bit of an old cynic, it remains to tell over time how many of these routes will actually come into being and whether they're actually sustainable for the long term. Now, smaller markets, as I mentioned, may need feeder passengers. But if you're flying already a small plane out of a smaller airport, you're probably not going to have other flights feeding in to top up your load. So there is going to be a challenge there. And we've seen Norwegian, for example, opening some routes out of a number of Irish cities, not only at Dublin, but places like Shannon and Cork. I think what's going to be interesting is to see how those routes to the USA from Norwegian perform this winter. Will they do sufficiently well on a wet Tuesday morning in February as they would do on a hot summer's afternoon in August? That's going to be the real litmus test of the ability of this model to grow. I do, however, think that the model is here to stay. And last week, IAG, the parent group of British Airways, Aer Lingus and Iberia, who have opened their own low-cost long-haul airline Level, they were talking to investors last Friday. They've indicated that their low-cost airline will grow to a fleet of about 30 aircraft. They only have two currently, and they could conceivably see a business case for a much larger operation. But what the CEO of the group, Willie Walsh, said on Friday was, this is not for everyone. You could easily set up an airline of this kind and lose a lot of money. So you've got to do it the right way, with a low enough cost base and with that very important feed, which in the case of IAG, they can deliver feed to Level via Vueling, their short-haul low-cost airline. And I think another element to reflect on as we watch how the long-haul low-cost model develops is, we come back to this low cost of fuel currently. How well will this model perform when fuel prices do at some point go way up high again, go through the ceiling? Some airlines will still perform well, others may then fall by the wayside and find it's just too much to make the model work. Now, looking at some of the other challenges and sources of turbulence in the last year, well, security, sadly, is a problem all airlines have to face, all airports have to face. I think it's here to stay. A few years back at the WTM, everyone was reeling from one or two significant terrorism attacks. Now it's almost every week or so we hear of something that's happened in some major world city, including cities here in Europe. The good side of that is that although it causes a shock to demand, we're increasingly getting evidence that customers are, it's not right to say they're getting used to it, but they are taking it in their stride, and people are still traveling, or if they desert a particular market, they are coming back. I've been personally surprised and encouraged to see, for example, Turkey, which last year had a number of terror attacks. It also had an attempted coup. It really was not a good year for Turkish tourism or Turkish airlines. But if you look at the data, the strength of the recovery has been enormous. It just shows that there is an ability to come back from very challenging situations. On the other hand, from an airline point of view, when a number of markets like Turkey and like Egypt, Tunisia, they all came off the market as customers drained away, airlines can't wait to see when those markets will come back. They have to move their capacity very quickly to other markets where they might be able to get a return and deliver profitability on those aircraft. So all the airlines piled their capacity into the Western Mediterranean, into markets like Spain and Portugal, which comes back to the question I mentioned earlier of low price. It's been very good for consumers, but not so good for airline profitability. And that means that companies like Monarch have ultimately bitten the dust and paid the price. Brexit is the topic of the moment. This is a big challenge to airlines here, not only in Europe, but airlines flying in and out of Europe, whether they are members of the EU or not. Ever since the Brexit vote result was announced, now nearly a year and a half ago, airlines have faced big challenges. Exchange rates have changed. The pound has gone into free fall against the euro and the dollar. That's meant uncertainty about demand from certain markets for airlines. It's also put up a number of airline costs which are dollar denominated. So quite big headaches for the airlines to have to face. But on top of that, as we go through the process of political negotiation, airlines don't know yet what this may mean for their licensing, particularly airlines who are licensed to the UK. Will they find themselves as no longer being designated as an EU carrier and then no longer able to fly the kind of routes they've been doing today within Europe but outside the UK? And we've seen EasyJet, for example, already moving to acquire a new operating license to circumvent that problem. And traffic rights, well, if we went back to the kind of traffic air service agreements that existed before the EU, we'd simply find ourselves in a position where between the UK and, say, France or Germany, you might have only one or two airlines being allowed to fly those routes. In the case of the USA to Europe, you could find that airlines who today fly in and out of Heathrow might suddenly find they're no longer allowed to, because in the past, a number of air routes, if they flew into London, had to fly to Gatwick. So no airline wants to see that happen. And for that reason, they are engaging with politicians, engaging with civil servants in the UK and in Brussels to try to make sure we preserve the open skies agreements we have today. And we've got an industry champion in the form of Michael O'Leary. He's shouting from the rooftops that in little more than a year and a half, we could all find ourselves grounded if these agreements are not retained, if there is any political brinkmanship. Now, many other people in the industry don't believe that will actually happen, but I think it's good for the industry that someone is up there shouting loudly, pointing out what the extreme could be if this is not negotiated quickly. And now, only a matter of months away. You know, we're soon going to be in the spring of next year. By then, airlines need to know what they're going to put on sale for the following summer. So it's very important from an airline industry point of view that these politicians do move quickly, don't try to hold out for some point scoring or political brinkmanship, and get some kind of agreement put in place that protects the freedoms that exist today. Now, there are other challenges, of course, that are still with us, perhaps in some ways have always been with us. There's a lack of slot access at major airports. Again, in the UK, there's the discussion about a new runway planned in the southeast of England, in Heathrow Airport in 10 years' time. A great lack of capacity to facilitate tourism and the economic life of access to the UK here. There are ticket taxes such as APD, Air Passenger Duty, and other ticket taxes that governments like to put on to generate revenues without looking at the challenge that that also brings of higher costs, not just to airlines, but importantly to customers, who can actually put people off travelling, which then has a disproportionately negative effect on tourism. Something has to be done about that, and airlines are lobbying strongly to try to reverse that trend of ever-increasing taxes and the perception that the industry is a cash cow from a government point of view. And then we have a developing global pilot shortage now. Of course, Ryanair's had its own problems with this recently, but there is a pilot shortage around the world, and it's not going to go away. There's a bidding war going on to recruit pilots, to train pilots, and it's something that airlines have to treat seriously. There's a food chain, and we certainly know that pilots are being recruited by smaller airlines, such as regional carriers, are much more in demand. Those airlines, compared to bigger payers, are finding it more difficult to recruit pilots. So it's a big worry for the airline industry about how to handle that, until the days we get automatic aircraft, of course, and we just have one pilot planes or no pilot drones flying us around. And perhaps a strange one to put up are the challenges this last year, what I call self-inflicted wounds. Now, we've got one of the companies with us this afternoon who's made these self-inflicted wounds, but we've had three big incidents. We've had United Airlines getting in the spotlight for the wrong reason, having a passenger dragged off one of their flights in the full glare of social media. We've had British Airways, who a contractor evidently turned off an IT system and the whole airline went into meltdown on one busy May holiday weekend. And then, as I mentioned, most recently, Ryanair had their own self-inflicted wounds by having a challenge to change their pilot rosters and their pilot leave year and having to cancel thousands of flights. Now, none of those are great experiences. So, you know, what's going on in the industry? What have the airlines lost all sense of reality? Are they going mad, these airline leaders? Well, I don't think airlines look to create these kind of problems, but certainly they have to learn lessons. They have to learn lessons in making sure these big kind of lash-ups don't happen again. And I doubt whether in the immediate future we're going to see another overbooking challenge with United. I doubt whether we're going to see another big IT meltdown with BA. And Ryanair, well, the jury's still out in terms of how they're handling pilot recruitment, but the management there knows very clearly they have to get through this challenge quickly and get the show back on the road. They have to get back a good relationship with their pilots as well to move on to another busy summer next year. But the question is, are there better ways that airlines could communicate? What should they do about reputational damage? And how do they handle customer disbelief? Well, the three examples I've given you here, I think, are surmountable. I do believe airlines will get through these challenges. The other challenges I've talked about today are big, but you know, the airline industry isn't an industry for weaklings. You've got to be in here with a thick skin, you've got to be tough, you've got to fight the battles day in, day out. And I think we'll still be talking about some of these same airlines this time next year. So with that, I'll draw my comments to a close. I don't know if anybody has any points they want to quickly debate or questions they want to ask before we move on to the next session. Anybody want to ask anything or comment? Okay, well, thanks very much, ladies and gentlemen. Sit tight in your seats. We're just going to have a quick pause